Sir, I am grateful to you for this opportunity to speak on these two very important pieces of legislation. Sir, there is a hue and cry as to why surrogacy bill was not passed by this House. It does not hold much water, because if one looks at the report of the Select Committee, it observed that before passing the surrogacy bill, the government should bring ART bill first, as bringing surrogacy bill before ART bill is irrelevant and also create duplication of votes. I compliment the Honorable Minister for taking up both the bills together, since surrogacy bill needs to be positioned and understood in close conjunction with ART bill. Sir, with these preliminary submissions, I rise to support the bills moved by the Honorable Health Minister and thank Honorable Prime Minister Shri Modi ji for understanding and safeguarding the reproductive rights and problems of surrogate mothers and addressing mushrooming growth of ART clinics, which are among the highest in the world. Sir, many of these clinics are violating ethical, medical and legal aspects. Not just this, we don't have standard protocols for ART clinics as yet. So these two bills are a step in the right direction, and the House is grateful to the Honorable Prime Minister and the Health Minister for this move. Sir, first I would like to make my brief submissions on the surrogacy bill. According to some studies conducted, surrogacy and fertility business in India is to the tune of about 30,000 crores, with clinics running into thousands across the country, offering artificial insemination, in vitro fertilization and surrogacy. So the growth rate in surrogacy is 20%, and the fact that 10,000 people are coming to India only for surrogacy gives a clear picture of surrogacy market in the country. So there are unregulated sperm and ovum banks which should also be regulated. So there is one more side to this issue. Surrogacy and ART are two expensive procedures, and it is beyond the reach of poor, lower middle class and middle class people, as they are not able to afford the expenses and are looking for finances. We all know that no bank gives loan for IVF, and IVF is not covered by any insurance company. So private finance companies are mushrooming and luring the above section of people with loans and EMI facilities for surrogacy and artificial intelligence. Further, we have no public insurance cover for infertile couples, as the patient pays out of pocket their expenses for fertility treatment and often have unrealistic expectations, which leads to dissatisfaction, unnecessary litigation and exploitation. So therefore, we need to safeguard the interest of our healthcare providers, along with looking after the benefits of our infertile couples, donors and surrogates. I appeal to the Honorable Minister to see how government can ensure, regulate and monitor these serious concerns. So my next point is relating to clause 2P of the bill, which defines infertility. So the definition says that inability to conceive after 5 years of unprotected coitus or other proven medical condition preventing a couple from conception. It means couple has to prove infertility to become eligible surrogacy. But sir, there may be other medical conditions where a woman may conceive but it is unable to carry a child due to medical complications, and there may be other medical conditions such as multiple fibroids in uterus, hypertension, etc., that may affect pregnancies. Since these conditions are not included under clause 2P, such women become ineligible to undertake surrogacy. There are countries like South Africa, Greece, Netherlands who are permitting such conditions. So I request the Honorable Minister to kindly look into this point. Sir, I welcome clause G of the bill, which defines couple, and the bill allows only infertile Indian couple are permitted to opt for surrogacy. I welcome that it bans foreigners and commercial surrogacy. I request the Honorable Minister to consider permitting NRIs, unlike OCIs, as they are still citizens of our country. So the next point I wish to make is to relating to the clause 4, which deals with getting certificate of essentiality and certificate of eligibility, and it prescribes various conditions. But your appropriate authority rejects application. There is no provision under which aggrieved couple can go on for appeal. Sir, as per the bill, if one application is rejected, there is no other option for couple to appeal, sir. But sir, I am sure Honourable Minister must be aware that in Transplantation of Human Organs Act or the Juvenile Justice Act, you have made provisions for appeal. I request the Honourable Minister to look into this point and permit at least one review and appeal to the couple, since the very objective of the bill is to facilitate couple get a baby. Sir, Clause 4(3)(b)(2) talks about close relative. I was looking at the definition of close relative under Clause 2, but did not find one, sir. The bill mainly focuses and hangs upon close relative to be a surrogate. Since this term is so significant and important in the bill, I feel if it is clarified a bit, it will become easy to identify who constitutes close relative, and people wanted to know whether members of the HUF are permitted. I request Honourable Minister to kindly clarify this point.
Please go back to your seat.
So, sir, surrogacy is a progressive bill and aims to stop spurring a human extractive industry, emphatically called surrogacy, involving huge amount of money, mostly at the cost of surrogate.
Well,
secondly, there is also a need to bring awareness about various aspects of surrogacy to the people of this country. I now just come to the assisted reproductive technology bill and make a few points on that, sir. Sir, as rightly pointed out in the statement of objects and reasons, ART in the country has gone up by leaps and bounds, and according to the Indian Society of Assisted Reproduction, there are nearly 27.5 million infertile couple, which is about 10 to 15% of married couple in the country. Sir, having a baby is the dream of every woman, and the Indian woman feels that she is complete only when she attains motherhood. So ART is one more method of helping women to realize that dream. Every infertile couple's inspiration is Louis Brown, the first IVF baby, born in 1978 for the world, and Durga, born in India the same year. The world has travelled a lot in IVF, sir, but unfortunately we do not have regulations and legislation till now. And I compliment the Honourable Sri Manveji for bringing this legislation, which is very, very progressive. This legislation will bring in standardization of protocols and reporting of cases. It also mandates that all clinics should provide professional counselling about implications and chances of success of ART procedures under Clause 21 of the bill. It helps couples to know the progress and prospects of their becoming parenthood. Sir, even though Clause 25 permits clinics for conducting pre-implantation testing to screen human embryo for genetic disorders, the beauty of the legislation is it provides offering couple or women of giving information of a predetermined sex. The next point I wish to make is about exploitation of ART procedures, sir. Be it negligence in surgical procedures, in harvesting eggs from women, preservation issues, sex selection procedures done by ARTs, commercialization of ovum and sperm donations, etc. I think we also have a movie on sperm donation by name Vicky Donor. So there is a need to safeguard the ART procedures from exploitation by vested interests, sir. I am saying this because, as I mentioned earlier, we have more than 40,000 ARTs, but nobody knows how they are functioning, whether they are following regulatory measures and guidelines properly, etc. So I appeal to the Honourable Minister to see that banks and clinics formed under Clause 15 of the bill should be vigorously monitored, regularly inspected, and for this, a national body with the representative from all the states, comprising of eminent reproductive specialists, gynecologists, eminent legal practitioners, embryologists, social scientists, apart from representatives for the ministries, should be formed. Further, as all of us know, sir, infertility is a public health issue and a public health risk, as there are many people who cannot afford the medical treatment for infertility. Insurance cover, cash claims should be provided to them, and accordingly an amendment be made in the Insurance Act if possible, sir. Sir, with these submissions, I support the bills, and once again compliment the Honourable Health Minister for these progressive legislations. Thank you, sir.